Hello and welcome to Jason's Macintosh Museum. I'm Jason, your host, and this is part two of a video series on the Apple Lisa, aka the Macintosh XL. Now in the first video, which if you haven't watched, I suggest you do watch, I'll put a link to it up on the video. In the last video, we talked about the history of the Macintosh XL and Apple Lisa, how they were developed, how they evolved, and what became of them. Now, in this video, I'd like to talk a bit more about the machine, specifically in terms of its specifications, and also look at the outside of the machine, look at the inside, and show you how to disassemble an Apple Lisa. So, as I mentioned in my last video, there were several versions of the Apple Lisa that were released. The first version was released in 1983, and that can be identified by having two floppy drives, two large 5¼-inch drives built in. Then the Lisa version 2 came out in January, I think it was January of 1984, which looked like this. So the twin drives were replaced by a single 400K, 3½-inch disk, similar to what, exactly the same, in fact, as what the Macintosh used. And there were a few other small changes, and the front panel was also redesigned. Now, the Lisa 2 then evolved in January of 1985 to the Macintosh XL, which really was nothing more than a Lisa 2 that had special software called MacWorks that allowed it to emulate a Macintosh 512K, which then of course gave you the ability to run all of your Macintosh software. So all of those versions, though, internally they were very similar in that they all used a Motorola 68000 CPU running at 5 MHz. Now they came as standard, I believe, with 1 MB of system memory, which was a lot for 1983 when you think about it. Although later versions, I believe there was a cheaper version that only had 512K of memory. Most of them had 1 MB. Now that was expandable. I think it was expandable up to about 4 MB or even more probably. But that you needed third party expansion cards, aftermarket expansion cards, to do that. But the standard configuration went up to 1 MB. Now, the Lisa 1, of course, had twin 880K floppy drives using 5¼-inch disks with a very unusual shape. I'll put a photo up so you can see what they look like. But the Lisa 2 had a single 400K, 3½-inch floppy, which was really the single-sided floppy as it was known, and that was used by the Macintosh models as well, up to the Macintosh 512K. Now, in terms of hard drive storage, you could in fact have a hard disk with the Apple Lisa, but there are several different types, so I'll be talking about that in a later video when I talk about hard drive expansion and upgrades for the Apple Lisa and Macintosh XL. Now, other than that, some had a parallel port on the rear. The newer versions did not, such as this one. They all had twin serial ports, I believe, on the back. There was also a mouse port and a port for the keyboard. And I think that's about it. So the Lisa 1 was released in 1983 at about $10,000. Very expensive then. The Lisa 2 came out 1 year later in January of 1984 alongside the Macintosh. And the price had been cut by that time. It was down to about $5,000. Still expensive, mind you, but a lot cheaper than it was. And then the Macintosh XL came out a year after that in 1985, which I believe that was only about $3,000. But by that time, Apple had pretty much given up on the Lisa and they'd stopped making it. So at this point, let's have a closer look at the Macintosh XL. Here we have the front view of the Macintosh XL. And I should mention, excuse the glare on the screen, you can see my reflection there, because in fact the CRT that was used on the Apple Lisa and Macintosh XL did not have an anti-glare coating, so try and ignore that. So you can tell that the Macintosh XL is, well, very different physically from any other model of Macintosh, mainly because, of course, it was simply nothing more than a slightly modified Apple Lisa. Yet despite that, there are a lot of similarities. You can see the horizontal stripes on the top of the case, which again are part of Apple's snow white design language that they used on a lot of their computers in the mid-80s. And you can see it has the same floppy drive slot as well, but we'll come to all that. So we'll start from the bottom. Now, the keyboard is designed to sit in this recess down underneath. And on the right-hand side, we have the power button, the little white button there, which actually lights up to tell you when the power is on. And the what looks like a headphone jack underneath is actually for the keyboard. The keyboard for the Apple Lisa actually used a, I think it was a 5mm, I think. It was a 5mm headphone-style plug. Which was unusual. No other Apple computer used a system like that, but that's what they did. Which of course means that you can't use a Macintosh keyboard, a regular Macintosh keyboard, with the Macintosh XL Apple Lisa. It must be a Lisa keyboard. So we have the power switch up above, and it's worth noting that one of the Lisa's features, which the Macintosh didn't really have until much later in its life, was the Lisa actually used it was actually a soft power switch. In other words, the machine was partially powered on at all times, and by pushing that button, the machine would start up. And what it would also do is when you shut the computer down, it would turn the power off automatically. So that was quite neat. And you could also shut the machine down by simply pressing the power switch. That would then tell the operating system to close all files and shut itself down properly rather than just killing the power. So that was quite neat. So moving up from there, we have the CRT. Now, as you can tell, it's a lot bigger than you'd find on a regular Macintosh. This one is actually a 9-inch. No, not a 9-inch, what am I saying? That's on a Macintosh. I think it's a 12-inch CRT. I'm gonna go and get a ruler. I'll be right back. I couldn't find a ruler, but I did find some measuring tape. So I believe it reads in inches. Yes, it does. So what's the diagonal? Oops. Let's see. 11 inches. There we go. So it's an 11-inch CRT as opposed to a 9-inch, which is what the other Macintosh models used. And it's still black and white. But the screen does have one interesting difference, which will become apparent when we try and run Macintosh software on the Macintosh XL, which is actually that the pixels are rectangular, they're not square. But we'll come to that when we look at the Macintosh XL actually running. So, moving over from there, we have the Apple logo down here. But note that there is no mention of the model. There is no mention of either the words Lisa or Macintosh or anything like that. Again, this was the only Macintosh model I know of that did not actually state, well, certainly in terms of older Macintoshes, the only one I know of that did not state the model name anywhere on it. It's not even on the back or on the bottom. Now up here we have the floppy drive. This is a single 400 kilobyte single-sided drive. That was used, the same version that was used on the Macintosh, the original Macintosh, the 128K and the 512K. You can upgrade these to an 800K double-sided floppy,
although this machine has not had that upgrade, it has the original drive in it. So that's the front view of the Macintosh XL. There's nothing really to talk about on the side, so we'll go straight to the back and we'll have a look at that. Here's the rear view of the Macintosh XL, and as you can see, very different from other models of Macintosh. So starting from the top, we have a lot of cooling vents up in the top here, and that's because, just like the original Macintosh, the Apple Lisa and Macintosh XL did not use a cooling fan, except when an internal hard disk was fitted. But if there was no internal hard disk, then the machine had no fans, and so you really did need these cooling vents to help help the hot air escape from the machine. Then we have the back panel, we have the Apple logo here, but again, no mention of the model at all. We've got more cooling vents here. Here is the back panel, and as you can see, the entire back panel comes off as one unit. And up here we have the two thumb screws that you need to undo in order to remove the back panel. But we'll come to that in a moment. So moving on from there, we have the brightness and I believe it's cutoff controls for the CRT, which normally do not need to be touched because the Apple Lisa and Macintosh XL have another very neat feature, which is that the screen brightness is actually software controlled. And that actually didn't appear on a Macintosh until I believe the Macintosh Classic, which came out in 1990. So this machine was certainly ahead of its time there. Then we have the power supply itself, and notice that it's marked as 1.8 amp. There are actually two different power supplies that the Apple Lisa used, aka Macintosh XL. I'll use those models interchangeably here. There were two versions of the power supply. One was a 1.2 amp, I believe, the other one was a 1.8 amp. And the 1.8 amp is the one to have because not only does it give you a higher output, it's actually a lot more reliable. And admittedly, if you're going to be running an internal hard disk in a machine like this, it's a necessity. So moving over from there, we have more cooling vents, and then we have the expansion slot covers. So the Lisa had three expansion slots, and one of them, as you can see here, actually would have had a card in it at some point. It was probably a SCSI card of some kind, which is no longer in the machine, but the back panel cutout is still there. And then down the bottom, we have all the different ports. We actually have the reset button, first of all. Then we have video out. Now, I believe this is, in fact, nothing more than a composite analog video signal. I have not tried to hook up a monitor to it as of yet, because from what I hear, that there are a few small differences in the way the signal is composed. But in theory, you should be able to connect this up to a television or any device that can accept a composite video input. We have the mouse port next to that, and this is the same mouse port that was used on the original Macintosh up to the Macintosh SE. So in fact, a Macintosh mouse that worked with those older machines will work on a Lisa and vice versa. Although technically I don't have exactly the right mouse for this machine, but I'll explain that later on. We have the first serial port, which I believe is RS-422, which is compatible with RS-232. Then we have the second serial port, and then we have the interrupt switch, which I believe works in the same way as the interrupt switch on a Macintosh. The camera's a bit jumpy. I haven't got steady shot turned on, I'll have to check that. So that's the rear view of the Macintosh XL, aka Apple Lisa. So at this point, we'll open it up and we'll have a look inside. Now, opening up an Apple Lisa is actually very simple. They've adopted the philosophy they used on a lot of the newer Macintoshes, in fact, where you don't need any real tools to disassemble the machine. So the first thing we have to do is we have to remove, well not remove, we have to loosen the two thumb screws at the top of the back panel. There's one here, and there's one over here. And it's worth noting they're captive thumb screws, so once you loosen them, they will stay with the back panel.
So if we just loosen these two, when they stop turning, you know that they're loosened all the way, and the panel simply lifts off just like that. So put that aside.
And so now what we have is we have the internals. What we have here is actually all the different circuit board cards. You can't see them all, they're all behind this one. But we have the power supply to the right, the expansion slots to the left. So the next step would be removing the power supply. And to remove that, all you have to do is, if you look down at the bottom of the power supply, we have one thumb screw to undo down here. And when you do that, you'll be able to lift the power, you'll be able to
take the power supply right out, slide it right out. So that should be loosened by now. So if I pull on, this little tab here, I should be able to, this is still stuck. There we go. And now
the power supply is loose and it can be pulled out of the system like so. There we go. So far it's actually quite easy to work with. So that's a closer shot of the power supply. It's a single module and it has a single edge connector there that connects to the back plane. Okay. The next step would be to take out the, well, I don't know what you'd call it, probably the CPU or the CPU card cage, I think it's called, the card cage. Because all of the various circuit boards in the Lisa plug into a main backplane, which is actually the backplane down at the bottom here, where all the ports are. So to remove the cards, you have to remove the cage in which they sit. And that's very simple. You simply grab hold of the cage and just slowly rock it back and forth to free the connector, and it comes out just like that. We will take a closer look at all of these later on, of course. That's the card cage out. So all you're left with in the back is the two connectors for the card cage. You can see there, we have the power supply edge connector there. And not much else down in here. That's where the back of the CRT protrudes out, so there's a cover on that. So what we'll now do is we'll now turn the machine around and we'll take off the front panel. Okay, so here's the front view of the Macintosh XL, and disassembly from the front is very straightforward, just like it is from the back. So the first step is to take off this front cover, this panel here. Now to do that, there are two clips, one down here and one over here. And you need to push up on them very, very carefully, and then you can swing the bottom of the front panel out, then drop the panel down, and the panel will come away. So you very, very carefully push up on these, and the bottom of the front panel will release out, then you drop it down, and it comes away. These are the clips that I'm talking about on the bottom of the front panel. One there, and one there. And notice that they're nothing more than plastic clips, so you don't want to bend them or apply too much force to them because they may snap. Although the plastic this is made from is actually very, very good quality. It's not as brittle as the plastic used in some other models of Macintosh I've come across. So here we have the internals. The CRT obviously here on the left. Over here we have the drive cage, as it's known. So down here we have the 400K floppy drive. And above it we have, in this case, an internal hard disk, which does not work, but we'll come to that. But basically, this entire cage comes out as a single unit. So to remove that, you undo one thumb screw down at the bottom here, and then you carefully pull the drive cage towards you. But as you're doing so, you have to watch the cables. There's a little bit of slack on the cables as you pull it out. But once you get the card cage, once you get the drive cage out, a certain distance, you want to release the cables so you can pull the whole unit out all the way. So let's do that. Let's put this over here. I'm going to trip over the card cage. That would not be good.
So if you undo this thumb screw down here, and then we start to pull the drive cage out.
Let's check my angle on that.
So if I pull the drive cage out, if I tip it, you can see that we have some cables connected to the back. So we'll have to unplug these before we can go any further. And there's one down at the bottom of the floppy drive. And now we can pull the whole drive cage out of the system. So we'll have a closer look at this in a moment. Set that to the side.
You can see all the cables remaining in here, the ones that connect straight into the system. Now, these cables are captive, so don't pull too hard on them because they don't have a plug at the other end. These
ribbon cables here will terminate into the back of the edge connector that you saw on the back of the machine, so you don't want to pull too hard.
Now, one last thing I should mention on the front is if you're trying to use an Apple Lisa or a Macintosh XL, you may find if you have the front panel removed, you'll find that it won't turn on. Well, there's a reason for that. It's because of this interlock switch down here. This is a little micro switch that gets triggered when the front panel is in place. So if this switch is not triggered, then the power will not turn on. There's also a similar switch on the back panel. So if you have either the rear or the front covers off the machine, it will not start up. Although you can probably carefully wedge something in there to override it if you need to. So that is probably as much as we can take out on the front. The last step is to remove the top panel. And to do that, we have to turn the machine around and start from the back. So here's the rear view of the Macintosh XL. Now, to remove the top panel, there are actually two screws you have to undo, which are located up in here and up in here. So to get to them, I'm just going to tip the casing just so that you have a clearer idea as to where those screws are. If I carefully tip it, there we go. So actually seeing the shot, but you can now see more clearly the two holes in the top of the case where the screws are located. So there is one located just behind there, and another located just behind there. So all you need to do is get a small flathead screwdriver, undo those two screws. They're also captive screws, so they won't fall out, and then you can remove the top panel. So let me go and find a screwdriver, and I think I've got one here. Let's tip this back. Oh, it's still very heavy, even with the components removed. Flathead screwdriver. There we go. This will do. So let's try this. Screwdriver's up to the job. There we go. It's rather tight. There's one, and the other one is over here.
Okay. Okay, so at this point, we can remove the top panel. So to do that, all you do is you slide it, you tip it up, slide it forward, and off it comes. So to give you a good shot of what's inside from the top, I'll switch to another camera and we'll have a closer look. Okay, so here's a closer shot of the Macintosh XL. Now we have the top cover off, and you can see that the top cover is what you need to remove in order to gain access to the CRT and the analog board, or they call it the video board for this model. So you can see that we have the various components in there. Flyback transformer, where is that hiding? Oh, it's down the bottom there. Oh, lighting's bad. Come on, focus. Focus. There's the flyback transformer down there. There's the CRT. And there's the video board. So we've got various components on there. So the reason that this board is so much smaller than the analog board in, say, a regular Macintosh is because on a regular Macintosh, the analog board combines both the unit's power supply and the CRT circuitry in one. On this, as you know, the power supply is a separate module, so all this has to do is control the CRT. Get a better shot of anything in there. That's all in there. Mm-hmm. Got some more of the cables down there. And up here, I should mention, is where you have the adjustment controls for the CRT itself. All there. That's the top view of the drive cage. So you can see the cables I was talking about, these ribbon cables, they terminate directly into the back of this edge connector over here. So you don't want to pull too hard on them. There is actually a little cable tie sitting there, another one over here, which keeps them in place, but it's just a word of warning there. So that's about it from the front. We might actually tip this up and have a look at the underneath, the underside of it, because the underside is actually where you will find the information labels.
Here's the underside view of the Macintosh XL, and the reason I've done this is because this is where you'll find the information labels. They're not on the back as they normally are. No, they're underneath on this one. Not quite sure why that is, but so starting over here, we have, looks like a summary label of the machine serial number, its AppleNet ID, and looks like a date code as to when it was manufactured. I'm not sure how you decode the manufacturing date code, though, unless it was the 333rd day of 1984, which is possible, I suppose. Not quite sure. But over here we have the slightly more generic information label, which is unfortunately on its side. But let's see what we have anyway. So we have Apple computer, model number, A6S 0200, which I believe means that it is a Macintosh XL, I think. I believe it is, or at least it's a Lisa 2 that's been upgraded to be a Macintosh XL. And memory options, A6S 0204. So I presume that would mean that it's had the extra 512K of memory fitted to take it up to 1 megabyte. Made in USA, of course, back then. Various other generic things. Okay, so that's the underside view. So what we'll do now is we'll take a look at each of the components that we pulled out, such as the drive cage and the card cage, and we'll have a closer look at them.
So here is the card cage from the Apple Lisa or Macintosh XL. Now I'm using this camera because it's easier to work with, because we'll be pulling things apart and moving around a lot, so it's probably better to use this. So, looking at the card cage, what we have is a backplane, as you can see, a backplane board at the very bottom that all of the cards plug into. So we have four boards in total. We have an I.O. board, which is the one you're looking at here. We have a CPU board behind it, which is this one here. Then we have two memory boards here. And note that they're even color-coded, as you can see. Memory 2, memory 1, CPU and I.O. So that's to make sure you don't get the wrong board in the wrong slot, although the connectors are actually offset down here, so you can't physically install the wrong card in the wrong slot. So, but it's very, very easy to work with. Each board does a separate function. So the idea, of course, is if you have a faulty board, you can just swap it out. So to take these boards out, you simply undo the latch here, same on the other side. That releases the board, and then you can pull it straight up and out. Set that over here. So it's the same with the CPU board. Again, release the two catches, one on either side. Do it evenly so the board doesn't get twisted. Oh, that's free. And then you can pull it straight out. Now I should be holding it by the tabs here, but I can't do it. Can I do it one-handed? Yes, I can. Oh, so there's the, put that over there. So now we have the two memory boards. So same procedure with those. Pull those out. And now this one, you have to be careful of this tab here. There we go, so you pull up, oops, you pull up, this is hard to do one-handed, I may switch to another camera for this, bear with me. Okay, I'm back to my normal camera here to try and remove these CPU boards. So with these, once you pull up on the tabs, you should be able to carefully lift up. Out. There we go. That's one memory board, and the other one with the tabs, and it should come straight out. Is it going to come straight out? This tab, you have to bend it a bit further over. There we go. Put it on the back so it clears the top part. There we go. That's out. So there are the four boards. And all you're left with is the backplane, as you can see. So let's have a closer look at that. Okay, so here's the backplane board out of the Apple Lisa, and we've got the expansion slots over here. Got three of those. And over here we have the various connectors that each of the boards plug into. So we have two memory boards that plug in there. We have the, that one is for the CPU, and this one is for the I.O. board. And notice the connectors are actually offset, so you can't mix them up, which is a very good idea. Apple Computer Incorporated, and we have the Lisa, the original Lisa logo here. Get a better shot of that. There we go. So in fact, the Lisa version 1 had this logo on the front, but the Lisa 2 did not. Don't know why, but there you go. Copyright 1983. And at the top we have the edge connector that plugs into the back of the case where the card cage connects in, which then connects to all the other internal components of the system. So we'll just have a closer look at the actual card cage itself. So you can see that the cards are supported on both sides as they're slotted in with these little rails on the left and the right. And same there. And any expansion cards you put in are also supported up at the top by these little rails here.
And again, each slot is actually color code. Focus. And camera, come on. All right. How about you? I'll do a manual focus. Now that's zoom. That's focus. There we go. So you can see that each slot is actually color coded. And those colors match the color of the tabs on the board itself. This one, for example, is the memory board. You can see that it has a yellow tab. So it's very, very thoughtful. Very clever design. So that's the card cage and motherboard backplane out of the Apple Lisa. Now we'll take a look at each of the boards. Well, first up we have the CPU board out of the Apple Lisa. So let's have a look at what's on it. You will notice though that it's actually, for 1983, it's actually very well designed. Of course, there's no surface mount components on there, but everything's very logically laid out. It's very clean. And in fact, every single chip on the board, they've actually printed the name of the chip on the board next to it. So makes it very easy to identify. Focus. To identify what's what. Why is this camera doing that? Let me just back the camera away for a moment. Oh, that's even worse. We'll have to stay about there, I think. So starting from the top left, we have the little tab that you use to connect or to secure the card to the card cage. Various logic chips here, I have no idea what they do. But then we come to the big chip, which is the Motorola 68000 CPU. And you can see here it's actually clocked. Well, it looks like it's an 8 megahertz chip in this case. I assume that's what the G8 means after the MC68000, but in the Lisa it's clocked at 5 megahertz. And then down here we have the two system ROM chips, which are the original ROMs for a Macintosh XL, I believe, because I believe the XL had slightly different ROM chips to the Lisa 2 and the original Lisa. I'm not sure what the differences were, but I do believe that the ROM chips were slightly different. So we have the ROM chips there. We have various other components here, nothing that I can really identify. And that's, what else? Not much else there. We've got one literally capacitor down there. Corporate 1982, made in USA. Apple Computer Incorporated. That's probably the part number for the board itself. Clock crystal there. Not much else to really talk about there. Of course, we have the edge connector down at the bottom here that interfaces with the backplane. So it's a four-layer board. That's pretty sophisticated for 1983. So that's the front side. We'll quickly flip it over and we'll look at the back. It's going to just stand up. Yes, there we go. Not much to really talk about here, although I have to say it's a very good quality board. It's been soldered very, very well. It's certainly a testament to that, the fact this machine is still running some 30 years after it was first built. But of course, there are no components mounted on the bottom side of the board. There's nothing surface mount, of course, so not much else to really say. So that's the CPU board. Now we'll look at the I/O board. And because I'm too lazy to edit this, I'm just going to switch them like that. There. This is the I/O board. Okay. So again, we have the color-coded tab up here. And some ROM chips up here. I believe one of these is the video. I think this one is the video ROM. Or it could be the floppy controller ROM. I'm not quite sure. We have three ROM chips here. So I think one of them is probably a video ROM. One's probably a disk ROM or something like that. So moving along from there, we've got a clock crystal up there. Apple computer. That's the model number for the board. Oh, there goes. Says Lisa on this one. So that would, I'd say that's probably built. Oops. That's probably built in the 23rd week of 1984, probably. Various other components along here. We've got some larger chips down here. These two are interface chips, one for the parallel port and one for the keyboard. Now, you may be thinking, well, there's no parallel port on this machine, so why is there a parallel port controller? Well, there is a parallel port. It's actually internal, and it's used to control the internal hard disk. But when we talk about hard disks later on, I'll give you the full story on that. Keyboard controller, not sure what that does. Clock crystal there. That connector there, I presume that's probably for testing. It's not used in the machine. Nothing's connected to it when the board is installed. So I presume it's nothing more than a test jumper, a test port for testing the board after it's been assembled. Yeah, the components down here, more components down here. I forgot what that's for. Something to do with the mouse or the floppy drive, I think. Not quite sure. I believe actually the Macintosh uses a similar chip to that, I think. And here we go, Apple computer, copyright 1983. And then we have the edge connector down at the bottom here. That's about it. So that's the I.O. board on the Apple Lisa, aka Macintosh XL. Let's flip it over quickly. Not much to see there. So whoop, that can go. And let's grab another board. We've got memory boards. Let's grab a memory board. Now there are two boards like this in the Macintosh XL, but they're both identical. So of course we'll only need to look at one. So here's a 512K memory board for the Lisa or Macintosh XL. Once again, we have the color-coded tabs on either side. We've got made in 1982. Apple computer, copyright 1982. There's the board, the part number. And of course, we have basically a whole lot of memory chips. And I see they're arranged in upper byte and lower byte. So, Apple Computer Incorporated. Not much else to really talk about there. But it's just shows you how far things have come, that this entire board holds half a megabyte of memory. Boy, have things changed or what? Let's have a closer look at the actual memory chips that it's using. I believe they're nothing more than standard dynamic RAM chips. Let's have a look at one. Oh, look, put it upside down. Aren't you silly? Let's change that. There. Oh, no, that did not work. I nearly lost the board. Let's try that again. That's better. Focus. So, HM4864P3. Actually, an Apple branded chip. How about that? Hitachi, but with the Apple logo on them. So I presume the 3 is probably 300 nanosecond, I presume. It's considering it's 30-year-old memory. Probably couldn't get any faster back then. Okay, so that is the memory board, lopsided memory board. That's the memory board. Half the memory board. There we go. From the Macintosh XL. So we'll have a close look now at the drive cage. Here is the drive cage from the Apple Lisa or Macintosh XL. And you can see that it's a self-contained enclosure that contains both the floppy disk and, if fitted, the optional hard disk for the system. There's also a fan down here. So we'll have a look at from the bottom. So at the bottom, we have the 400K floppy disk that was used in the Lisa 2 and the Macintosh XL as standard. So looking at the mechanism, it's actually very similar to the same drive that was used in the original Macintosh. Whoop. In fact, you can see the date on it, January 1984. So this was the original drive. And I believe it was made by Sony, if I remember correctly. So that's the 400K floppy drive. And back of it, we've got the standard interface connector for it, which plugs in there via ribbon cable, which then connects here. And that's where the Lisa's floppy drive cable would connect to. Next to it, we have a fan. Now, the fan is fitted here because this drive cage has the optional hard disk inside, although it's not the original disk. So I'll go over that quickly. So basically, if you had an Apple Lisa, you could specify either an external or an internal hard disk. Well, I should mention, if it was a Lisa 1, all you had was an external hard disk. It was called the Apple Profile, which was a big box that sat on top of the machine. It was a 5 megabyte hard disk. But when the Lisa 2 was released in 1984, you were able to specify an internal 10 megabyte disk, and this is where it would normally go. It was called the Apple Widget, and it was more or less, I believe, a Seagate drive with a custom Apple controller. So the drive would sit here, and the controller would sit above it. Now, this machine at some point was upgraded to an updated controller and an upgraded hard disk. This one actually has a 40 megabyte MFM hard disk. Now, if I unplug these, we can probably see, take these cables out of the way, we'll be able to see the drive. Okay, so here's the disk. It's a Fujitsu MFM hard disk, model number, let's see, M2227D2. Made in Japan, so this is a 40 megabyte MFM hard disk with an internal stepper motor to control the heads. And you can see, if we have a look at it, you can see here the MFM connectors on the drive. There they are. So it's a standard PC hard disk in that sense. So might should take the disk out and have a closer look at that as well. And on top, we have the updated drive controller. Now, if you remember from my first video, I talked about a company called Sun Remarketing, who developed a lot of upgrades and other options for the Lisa after Apple had discontinued it. One of the things they offered was hard drive upgrades, and this is an example of that. So if I sit that there, whoop, this is a Apple Lisa MFM hard drive controller. And what it enabled you to do was to connect any PC standard MFM hard disk to an Apple Lisa. So you can see this is the controller board here. Logan, Utah, that's where they're from. Sun Remarketing from Logan, Utah. So this was made, I would say, sometime in the mid-1980s. And it's a controller board that connects to the Apple Lisa via a internal parallel port connector there and a power connector there, and then let you hook up a regular MFM hard disk via the control and the data connections that you see there. So on this board we have a few components, various microcontroller, I think that's a microcontroller there, a couple of RAM chips, one there, probably a custom CPU there, and a ROM chip there. So when working, this would allow the Apple Lisa to use a 40 megabyte internal hard disk rather than Apple's own 10 megabyte disk, which gave you much more storage space and was a lot faster as well. Unfortunately, it looks as though either on this machine, the drive or the controller has failed, but we'll come to that when we try and use the machine.
So why don't we get a closer look at the hard disk now, see if I can get a closer look at it. That's the, no, that's... I may have to take the drive out, I think. I'm going to... Yes, I'm going to pull this apart and we'll have a closer look at the components of the drive cage. Okay, I've switched to my other camera to give us a better view of the drive cage. I've taken the controller board out, so you can see the hard disk. So this is the Fujitsu 40 megabyte hard disk that is used here. And note that, like a lot of old hard disks, they print the various defects on a label on the top of the disk. So the idea behind this is if you were low-level formatting the drive, you would have to enter these defects into the software so that it knew it was made aware that those are sectors that are not to be used. Of course modern hard drives do all this automatically, and yes, I did take the cover off the disk and trying to get it going. That's why that label has been tampered with there. But so that's the hard disk. Then the underside of the disk. We've got the MFM connectors there and the rest of the circuitry down there. So here's the floppy drive. So that's the 400K floppy drive. Nothing special there. And just like the newer drives, it has the auto-eject mechanism. You can see that little rod there that actually pulls on the drive mechanism to eject the disk. It's actually got its own motor sitting in behind there, a big motor that actually pulls the mechanism. So that's the drive. So I believe you can use any Macintosh 400K drive with an Apple Lisa or Macintosh XL. Don't quote me on that. And here's the cooling fan, which was used to cool the enclosure when a hard drive was fitted. Okay, so that's the cage. So we'll have another quick look at this controller. So what do we have here? Let's set that down. So this is the controller that Sun Remarketing developed to use so that you could use MFM hard disks with an Apple Lisa. So again, we've got the power connector there, the power cable from the Apple Lisa would connect to. We've got the internal parallel port connector for data, and the fan plugs into that. Focus. Ugh. The fan plugs into that connector there. Then various components, again, ROM chips, other microcontrollers, parity generators, I believe they are, and then a few other bits and pieces that translates the commands to MFM capable commands. Because remember, with MFM hard disks, the controller wasn't built into the drive. The drive really had no intelligence of its own. It relied on an external controller to tell it where to position the head. And that's why you had a control connector, which is this one, and a data connector, which is this one. The control connector would tell the drive physically where to position the head, and the data would be sent back on this connector here. And that's actually where the term IDE came from. It stands for Integrated Drive Electronics, which means that the drive has its own controller built in. But back in the mid-80s, that wasn't the case. So there's the controller. And there's the drive cage. So what we'll now do is I'll now get the system reassembled, and this will be the end of this video, and then we will be looking at the Apple Lisa in operation in the next video.